Okay, they're ready.
Please take your seats. We are going to start. Welcome back from lunch break. We are now starting right ahead with Peter. Peter Raymond. Chris. Talking about, not about scholarly Linux, EDLEDU, or his contributions to various documentations on the Debian installer, but about enterprise ready software for Debian.
Not for
eBay,
actually.
Okay, enterprise ready software.
Yeah, and someone asked me. someone asked me earlier if this is based on my experience with school Linux and eBay, but it's not really. It's mostly based on my experience from working for Norwegian Telecom and the universities in Oslo. Well, the university in Oslo and Tromsø. And. The main topics of this talk will be a few stories on how things work when you have a lot of machines, a lot of users, and have to take special considerations when you do things. And then a few tips for those who write software, and then I go into more detail with the multi-level configuration. And some people do not realize the difference between administrating one computer or just a few computers and administrating a lot of them. There is a few things you can do with one or two computers, which is impossible to do when you have thousands. Once we screwed up at university, we managed to distribute the shd.conf file for all the macOS 10 boxes, approximately 700 boxes, which broke SSH. So the only way we could get in and fix it had been broken. And how do you fix 800 machines? You do not walk around to each and every one of them and try to fix the configuration file like you would do if you only had one computer or 10 computers. It's not possible because 10% of them are in Kuala Lumpur on a research trip. Some of them are in a locked room where the owner of the key has taken a 2 years research trip. It's not possible to only walk in to the display of the machines and fix them. So we had to come up with a better way. And in this particular case, we thought about it for a while, a few weeks. We tested on a few users and came up with a shell script that was available on a telnet port. And we made a one-liner and a web page that would inform the clueless users how to cut and paste, start the terminal, cut and paste, run the command and actually recover SSH so we could get in and fix the rest. And this is not an obvious solution for standalone machine system administrators. And this way we moved the workload from the few staff that were sitting centrally. We had two people administrating the 700 macOS 10 boxes into each and every system administrator locally and the user himself, which is kind of important when you're running on large installations. So another common problem we have with crappy software. This is not like a local screw-up, it's more like a common problem with a lot of user applications in the free software world and in the commercial world as well. If you have a lot of users and a lot of home directory servers, the user will stay there for probably like 6 to 10 years. They will move from one home directory to another during this period. And when you do this, you tend to break GIMP, Mozilla, OpenOffice, Opera, I think KDE at some point will get confused. There's a lot of applications that actually believe that the home directory of a user will never move, so we can actually record a path as absolute path from the root instead of from the user's home directory. And this is a really annoying problem that's so easy to fix, and almost no free software has actually done this because the author has actually never realized that home directories move. And then you have the other problem we have with lots of machines. We have approximately 900 Linux machines. Some of them run KDE, some of them run GNOME. And some of them don't use the same version of GNOME and KDE. And when a student goes to a student lab and logs into one version of KDE, and then that goes to another student lab with another version of KDE, and then go back to the first one. This breaks, because KDE, as one prime example, do not handle downgrades of configuration files. It will automatically rewrite the configuration and on upgrades, and then go crazy on downgrades. And I suspect that a lot of people, when I try to tell them this, it's like, well, don't downgrade. It's like, stick with one computer and stay there. It's not an option for us. We have too many pupils, or too many students, too many teachers, and too many machines. And then you have the old binary problem. So I like Solaris in this regard. They have really taking backward compatibility seriously. I can take a 15-year-old binary on Solaris and run it on the latest Solaris machines, and it works. And this is actually important, because when you have professors telling their students to write some piece of software, and they take this piece of software into production, and they start using it in the research group, and then the student finishes, his master is over, his home directory is killed, and the source is lost forever, there is no way to recompile for the newer version of the operating system. The only option is a rewrite, and the professors don't tend to prefer that option. So backwards compatibility on the binaries is actually important. Not all the software can be rebuilt. And then you have the main reason why we don't use Linux as a file server at university. When you need to resize the database partition, you don't really want to take down the application or throw out the users. And at least I don't want to send an email to 30,000 users telling them that, oh, I'm sorry, during the last, or the next hour you can't do anything because we are like resizing the file system. It doesn't work well in an environment where it's impossible to actually reach 30,000 people and make sure you get the message through. So we prefer Solaris, HPUC, 364 I think have the feature to online resize or actually extend the file system. That's the most important thing. And recently, Red Hat got it for X3. I hope Debian will get it for X3 as well. I know Red Hat has have it, but we don't trust it. I know X has have it, but we don't trust it either. So we stick with the well-proven solutions that actually work. And this is important to get Linux into the enterprise. It's not production ready before you can do file system resizes or extensions without taking down the applications. And then another problem we have. We have approximately 500 servers in our machine room. And most of them have RAID systems. And a RAID is splendid if you have enough spare disks and get a notification when one of the disks fails. If you are not told when a disk fails, and the next disk fails, and the next disk fails, like it did when I was working at Norwegian Telecom, Media, which was a piece of the enterprise in Telenor, or Croatian Telecom, that was making phone directories. But anyway, we had a RAID system there, old DEC system, which didn't notify us that something went wrong. It was standing in the machine room, and we were very rarely in the machine room. And it had been standing there for, I think, 6 months, flashing a red light, before the last spare disk failed, and the whole system went down in flames. So a RAID system is not good if you don't get notifications when the system, the disks fail. And this is a real big problem with most RAID systems on Linux. And the only reason I like software RAID, because you can get information about when the disk fail. We have, as I said, 500 machines in the machine room. Approximately 300 of them are using a RAID system where we cannot get automatic information about the status of the RAID. So we actually have an operator. Spare time students pay to look after the machine room, walk around every morning and look for red lights. And then they send us an email and we track down the problem. And we do have some tools to actually get information out of these RAIDs. AlphaClean, a particularly good example of a crappy tool. You can get status out of it if it's okay. But when there is something wrong, it goes into interactive mode and wants you to say yes and no and stuff. So you can't actually script it. And we want something that we can put in a script and send off to our monitoring system. And all the RAID solutions in Linux tend to put the information in different forms. Some of them have it in proc, some of them don't. Some of them you need a binary tool, which is rarely available in the version you, or for the distribution you need. And if you are as lucky as a few, on a few RAID systems where the information is in proc, the file format of the files in proc are completely different on all of them. I would really like all the kernel developers making RAID drivers to agree on one common format and make sure the status information is available in proc. I don't need much. I just need okay or something is wrong. It would be great if it says that disk zero is broken or like rebuilding on disk four. But as long as I can get a message that's not something is wrong, go and look at the machine, check out whatever is wrong there, that would be really great for us. I think we have like Mega RAID 2 previous versions had that support. Taken out in the latest Red Hat kernels, and it's not in the Red Hat, no, the Mega RAID 2 drivers in Debian, I think. So it's really painful with RAIDs. And then you have a friend of mine's particular favorite, installing software. When you need to answer questions or click through a GUI or switch CDs when installing software, it becomes very painful. And I think it was Maple was the last application you have to do this. You have to run the GUI application on the machine and press yes or no and fill in the path at correct the time, and then you have to switch CDs. And when you compile it on 9 different architectures, it takes several days just to install an application. That's just so amazingly painful and stupid and prone to errors. It's impossible to make sure we get it right, and we want to make sure that when we upgrade, we do the same as last time, so we get the same configuration. And the only way to do it at the moment is document the process and try to make sure we actually get the steps right. But putting a person between the documentation and the installation application tend to add on errors. And then you have an old problem from the Norwegian Telecom. This was a large enterprise with a lot of different companies being organized together with a common network, and the network administrator of the complete network didn't necessarily agree with the network administrator of the local network. This, of course, was the same for system administrators, and we needed to get some application working. We needed a few ports open, and they were already closed because some other applications were using these ports for other things, and they didn't want to expose them. So if you have some application that can't be modified to use different ports depending on your needs, you are kind of screwed in these kind of situations. And then one of my favorites, versions two in a script language or a programming language. Given 3 PHP applications, which version of PHP should you use to get them all running with the same PHP implementation? If you are lucky, it's possible. If you're not, it's impossible to get them working on the same PHP engine. The same with Tickle. A lot of Tickle applications are impossible to get running with the same Tickle implementation. And this makes it a lot harder to administrate these applications, because we have to have 3 different versions of Tickle, we have to secure 3 different versions of Tickle, we have to install, we have to upgrade. It's very painful when you have to do this for a lot of applications. Each problem like this just accumulates until it's impossible to administrate a large network. And then one small story from a program I tried to use a few years ago. I clicked on the menu, nothing happened. I clicked again, nothing happened. And it was printing an error message. It said that it couldn't read the printcap file. And it printed it to a standard out. This was a GUI application, so I was waiting for the window. And I didn't look into .xerrors, x session errors, is it? Before a few hours later, when I started to have a GUI application provide the error messages as a dialog box or a pop-up or something, because the user is not going to check the standard out when he selected the application on the menu. And then on for some clues for the clueless. I'll go through this in some detail, but I have only 15 minutes left, so I'll do it fairly quickly. Three levels, at least three levels of configuration files. I'll cover that with multi-level configuration a bit later on, but it will help us a lot because we are configuring applications for the university and then provide some hooks for the local administrators that they can, or the sites, like the department administrator at the mathematical sciences department, so they can do some overrides, and then the local professor can do some other overrides, and we don't want to step on each other's toes, so it would be easier if we could have different files and the result merged together. And compiling software, never ever ask questions during compile time. We need to script it. We need to script it so it's the same when we do security patches and updates. And there are some patches that believe that there is some administrator that loves to sit and answer 10,000 questions. Is this file going there? Do you actually have this library? Is it working? This must be scriptable. Perl has it fairly well. They do go into interactive mode, but you can override it and go for non-interactive mode. If you really want to have this question asked, make sure you have an override so you can get rid of them. And it would be nice if you, when you make the install target and you need some special privileges on the files you install, that you split the installation task into two steps, one to actually copy the files in there and the last one to fix the permissions. When we install software at the university, we compile everything as a non-privileged user. And when they try to set permissions, it doesn't work. And normally, these stupid applications will fail to install because they couldn't set root ownership on a directory or stuff like that. Please make it two steps so you can do one step as the normal as a normal compilation and one step with sudo access. And another thing, make sure the software can be installed anywhere. It's very painful to try to get something installed in slash local bin when the binary packet only accepts to be stored in user local bin. This is mostly a problem for commercial software, but it's sometimes also a problem for free software where you have to reprogram or change the source to actually be able to install it in some non-default location. And I guess this is pretty obvious for you, but please make the source available so we can actually fix things when they break. And yeah, we tend to have software for 10 to 20 years, and the architecture we got on might not be the same that we need to run it on in the future. And as I said earlier, make paths into the home directory relative to the user home directory, always. Even if the user specified some full path that ended up in his home directory, rewrite it to be relative to the home directory. Because if not, the the application will break when the user moves. And a few conflicting clues, depend on as few libraries as possible. Because when you try to get a few pictures or a packet installed, I mean, it depends on like 100 libraries. Sometimes we just give up and go with a different application that does not maybe as good a job, but it's easier to install. Request tracker is a good example. It depends on heaps and heaps of Perl modules, and trying to get them working without apps on a Solaris machine is not really, really fun. And then of course, use as many libraries as possible, because it's a lot easier to upgrade or fix a security bug in one library instead of fixing the bug in all the different implementations of the same feature. But it's like, think about the dependencies and think about the pain you add when you depend on the library, and consider if it's worth it when you weight it against the convenience of security updates. And yeah, make sure libraries and programming languages are backwards compatible, because it's very painful to have to maintain different versions of libraries to get different applications working. And this is not too obvious to a lot of people. They tend to think that, oh, license writing, that's fun, let's make our own. But when you have to call in the legal department and spend a few months talking to administration to get them to accept a new kind of license, it's not so fun anymore. So stick with a well-known license, because big enterprises do need to evaluate licenses. And if it's like Pierre's homemade license, it's maybe not worth the pain, and we'll just not use the source because we don't have the time to evaluate the license. And when you write source, make sure you stick with the standard and not use vendor-specific extensions to the language. This is a big problem with free software, and probably you don't realize it because GCC is so full of extensions that you don't discover when you're using extensions. And up until now, it's been impossible or hard to get rid of the extensions and still have a working compiler and working system. And when we try to compile it on, I think it's 7 different compilers, the Sun Forte compiler, which is fairly good ANSYS compiler, the AIX compiler, which is a very good ANSI compiler, the H2 compiler, which is getting close to an ANSI compiler, 264 one is quite good as well, and then GCC. And normally GCC accepts everything, and the others try to limit it to ANSI-C. So it's a pain to get things compiled on the compiler versions or compiler vendor implementations. So if you can, please use minus ANSI. Please use minus pedantic. It might only be a warning in GCC, but it might be a fatal error in other compilers.
Pedantic does not do anything useful. Read the manual.
It used to.
No, read the manual.
You mean the Sun Forte manual, where I can see the ANSI
GCC information? GCC pedantic options don't do what you want.
We have
that's
a comment over here that the pedantic option doesn't do what you want, it doesn't do anything convenient, it doesn't do anything useful. Please read the manual. I guess it means the GCC manual.
Yes.
Oh well. And then we have the write portable code. Please avoid if tests based on architecture. Because it's very confusing when you have a bug that appears in one architecture and it's not in the other architecture. Or we have some feature that works this way in one architecture and this way in the other architecture, and you try to debug them and you don't really understand what's going on. Let the program do the same on all architectures. Let it fail the same way, let it read the same files, let it read the same or use the same applications. Try to be consistent across architectures. And it's also fairly important to get software to work out of the box. Because when you have 2,000 machines to administrate, you don't have a lot of extra time to play around with software. So if it works out of the box, the chances that we actually start using it is a lot better than if we have to spend about a week or two to read the manual and fix the configuration before it does anything useful. And out of the box is fairly important to like see the result that this is going to be useful. You can configure it to do exactly what you want when you actually understand that this software is something I need. But if you don't get to the point where you can see any results at all, at least we tend to give up and throw it away and do something else because we don't have more than 5 minutes to evaluate this piece of software. And resource leaks. There is quite a few pieces of software leaking resources like mad, so it's impossible to keep them running for a longer period of time. Free software has gotten a bit better with VolGrid. It seems to have miracles to some pieces of software, but still there are file descriptor leaks, there are X resource leaks, there are memory leaks, shared memory segment leaks, there are lock leaks, there are all these kinds of resources, and when you need to run the software for years and years at a time, you can't just restart a long-running server to fix the problem. Especially if the server is important for other services. And when you need to interrupt 60,000 users just because some programmer fucked up his source, you don't really want to use this software anymore. Another thing that the most free software developers seem to get right, at least when they're making daemons, is the use of syslog. But we do have a few pieces of software that believe it's a lot better to have their own log file stored away somewhere, no one actually looks at it. And it's normally impossible to reroute the log file into like our log server where we collect and process all the messages that happen. And we have quite a few pieces of software. This is common in free software as well, that will crash and die with no traces whatsoever of what happened. And when you try to debug a system that just vanished, you really want a clue of why. When you have a long-running bind server, bind is quite good actually, but let's take a DNS server. If you have a long-running DNS server that sometimes, once in a month, just disappears, and you have no way to actually attach anything to it to find out why, because it's so busy that if you try to run it in a Valgrind or a debugger, the server just stops completely. So you have to keep it running in normal mode, and you need to get some information about why it fails. Please syslog or write something to a log file or tell us why it crashed. Have some segfault handlers or anything to give a clue of why things crashed, because it's so painful to try to debug. Normally we don't have the time and just give up and add a restart every week kind of feature to the system, but it's not the best way to keep system administrators happy at least. And a few final clues. Reuse configuration when possible. If the information is already present on the system, do not make your own copy of it. One nice user application, Ktouch, which is a touch type kind of training system. It needs to be told the keyboard layout to use when it displays the keyboard. And this is not really new information to the system. X knows the layout. X keycaps can obviously extract it from X, so could Ktouch. And it's like all kinds of systems that should reuse information. The mail domain, it's not like every program needs to have their own mail domain. They can just fetch it from the system's mail domain. Or the IP address, do you actually need to tell it the IP address? Can't you just look at the interface? All these things, please reuse the information if possible and provide overrides. Well, sometimes the default is not good, but most often the default is great. And this is my second to last point on the clue list: provide local admin hooks. Local administrators want to configure a few things, they don't want to configure everything, they want the default because they want the software to be upgradable. And they know that every time they configure something, they will have to test it during upgrades. So if you provide just a few hooks for the local administrator to put exactly what he needs to configure in one file that will be kept and reused after upgrade, then you will make quite a few system administrators happy. And reduce flexibility. Have you seen the GM player? Or any other applications with skins? Would you like to tell your grandmother how to recover from a miss skin configuration over the phone? I would not. And every time something is complex to explain over the phone, every time there is some flexibility in the system, the support cost for the large enterprise increases. You get more people calling in and you get to spend more time to explain them, or actually first you try to find out what the problem is. then you try to find out what it looks like on their screen, and then you try to help them through the steps that is required to get back to the configuration they expected when they start the machine. So flexibility is nice in some ways and really painful in other ways, and for a bigger organization, flexibility is really bad. Any questions? Then we go over to the multi-level configuration. This is nothing new. A lot of applications have this already. But it's a very nice way to provide local hooks, upgradability, and different levels of configuration for the site, the local administrator, or the host administrator. The point is that we want local changes, local configuration to be kept during upgrades, and we want to keep the defaults when possible, and we want to make sure that the different actors wanting to have a say in the configuration can do so with their own file, and hopefully also with fixed overrides. Say a mail client, you want the site's configuration to say this is your mail server, this is the mail server everyone should use. And then you maybe want the local department to be able to say, okay, our user should use the local mail server instead. And this is not very easy with a few mail clients today. And you have web browsers. Maybe the site that the enterprise is providing a proxy. You want to make sure all users use this proxy. And maybe it should be optional, maybe it should be enforced. There is different ways of doing this, and providing multi-level configuration to make that possible, it's quite convenient. And well, the example here is read config from several files. I've suggested a few. User share foo config, site share foo config, etc foo config, user home directory dot foo config, and then the fixed, going back with the fixed files. The point is that when you need to enforce something, you put it in the fixed file. When you only want to give the user a sensible default, you put it in the non-fixed files. And this is the common thing in KDE. The .d directories give similar features. And this makes it a lot easier for the rest of us trying to use this software to get it upgradable and make sure it configures out of the box. We distribute the configuration files to all the machines. And for systems that use multi-level configuration, it just works. And some software almost got it right. You can provide default email configuration for Kmail, I think. But it's not that easy to put the username in the default configuration. And you want to specify the username in the, for example, the of the connection string to the IMAP server. So make use of some variables with well, common user features, user home directory, username, maybe user password, host name, stuff like that.
When you're writing some kind of configuration file, I mean, a lot of this functionality is duplicated. Is there some kind of standard way to write a parser, or does everybody have to write their own parser capable of variable substitution and that kind of thing?
There are several standard parsers to write or read configuration files.
Yeah, do you have any suggestions?
No.
Okay.
I think that's a fight against windmills, so I'm not going to even start there. Please make it easy to parse and write during using scripts, but that's all I have to say about configuration file formats. Don't make it binary.
Just to make sure that I understand, your last slide was a fixed.fixed configuration. You mean this configuration is used if the user something scrambled up in his home directory, it would not work with the current installation, or what is the sense that the last direction is user share foo config fixed?
The point is that given a configuration option in the program, it will be read first from the first file and then in the next file, and if it is present in the second file, it will override the setting in the first file.
Yeah.
And then it reads the next file and it will override it if it's present. And it will continue like that. And if it's present in the fixed file, which is after the user or user configuration, it will override the user's configuration.
Yes,
so if you want to make sure the user have a web proxy set, then you put it in the fixed file, because if the user tries to disable it in his own configuration file, it doesn't take effect because the later file will override it.
But if the user intended to have no proxy for whatever reason, he has no chance.
If you put it in a fixed file, that's the point. If the system administrator wants to enforce the use of proxies, he puts it in the fixed file. If he only wants to make an option, he puts it in the normal config file. Any other questions? And quite a few programs got it right up until the fixed part, where you can provide system defaults at several levels, but you cannot enforce any of the settings. I guess that's based on a political decision. Do the software author want the system administrator to be able to override his users or not? I think it's a useful feature, at least for our enterprise.
Right. You discussed basically technical issues. The whole presentation was about technical issues. Do you feel that there's a need, especially from free software, to have more support in some way? Be it, I don't know, maybe at least regression tests, reports, or anything like this?
Yes, there is. All free software is getting better. It's already quite good, and we already get quite good support for some pieces of software. But we could improve, definitely. And we need to take into account the need of the enterprise, because it's quite different from the desktop users. But I decided to focus on the software writing pieces of the enterprise problem, so that's why I stayed away from those problems you mentioned there.
Do you think that Debian is actually enterprise ready?
No, not even close. He asked, yeah, the Debian system is lacking quite a few of the features I need to be able to run Debian on all the Linux machines at university. But the biggest problem, I didn't mention, it's a financial business problem. We had to choose a Linux version that was supported by Oracle. And we only have two options at the time. We had Red Hat and SUSE. We were already using Red Hat, so we decided to not switch to SUSE because we didn't gain anything. And of course, Red Hat has since then gotten the extended resizing of file system feature and a few others, making it more feasible as a file server. But Debian is not, as far as I know, doesn't have any of these features.
And would you say that the other Linux distribution ready, actually?
For some things, for other things, no. Red Hat is getting close to being useful as a file server. It's already used quite a lot as a web server and database server. Depends on your use, but you can't use like Linux all over in the university at the moment to replace all the Unix machines. That's not possible. There was a question over there.
Almost the same question as the person before, but what is someone intending to do something for Debian to go into this market for enterprises? Because I don't think it's more a technical question, it's more a financial question. Because if people are buying hardware from Dell or IBM or wherever, they want to have the support, and Debian is far away to give any support for those kind of persons or enterprises. So Debian will never go into this market for enterprises.
I think that's quite wrong. It's difficult for our companies providing support for Debian. And I don't think Debian needs to provide enterprise support as such.
No,
because they have companies already doing it. And we have quite a lot of businesses using Debian in production systems already. The Norwegian University Network organization is using Debian almost on all the network equipment, and it's already in use, and they get support if they didn't want it. They can buy support from a lot of companies. So I don't think that's a really big issue. I don't think Debian needs to provide commercial support.
I don't think Debian needs to provide, but there's a gap between the hardware vendors and the enterprises who are using the hardware. Because if I buy hardware from Dell, and Dell is supporting Red Hat or SUSE, I don't intend to buy from a third company another product to what I usually get almost free from the hardware vendors. So basically, if Dell tells me I'm only supporting SUSE or Red Hat, what are the chances that an enterprise is going to install Debian on the hardware?
Well, I think they're quite good if you actually want Debian. And Debian has a few...
I can get any support from Dell. I can get it from, as far as I know, from IBM. If I want to install Oracle, for example, I don't have an option except using Red Hat or SUSE.
Oracle is a very good example that you can get support. But for other things, you can get support. And we are... when we buy 200 machines from Dell, we can decide what they should install on the machines. So when you buy a lot of machines, you can pick your own operating system, but then you get support from somewhere else, and support, the software support from Dell, I wouldn't pay much for it.
Just a comment on the software support thing. One of the potential solutions for getting software support for more than just Red Hat and SUSE or some other high-profile distros is the LSD. Assuming we can get that to work, that may end up being a solution for getting enterprise support on Debian.
Any other questions, comments?
Thanks for listening.
This was my first talk on this topic, so I'm pretty sure my slides could get a lot better. Just provide comments and feedback. I would really appreciate it.
Okay. Now we have a 10 minutes break. We will be